Bitch,
welcome to another episode of The Coach's Corner. With me, as always, Trevor Jaffe, for those of you who need that help with pronunciation of the last name. What's up, man?
According to you, I have a very healthy prostate. I'm not going to go into any stories or details of how you've diagnosed this, but Tony says I have a very healthy prostate, so I'm winning today.
Over the phone. Diagnosed it over the phone, not in person. So just so everyone knows, in-person diagnostics costs a little bit more money than just this phone call.
We're doing remote diagnosis of prostate exams.
Yeah, yeah, that's the wave of the future, so I'm excited about that.
Actually, it is. There's concierge.
Dude,
it's like a huge business. I think like Walgreens invested in it, Walmart invested in it, and they started buying Amazon too. They started buying like concierge service medical things. So you used to be able to do a concierge medical doctor. Good, you know, not buy insurance, and you just pay the doctor like a certain amount per year, $3,000, and you see them twice a year. They do exams, they do physicals, they do the whole nine, and then they like filter medications to you as provided they're not outside of the network kind of things. I knew several doctors who did that, so that way they can only see like 100 patients instead of having thousands of patients, or they can spend more time with patients, so they develop a business that way. If you do the math, you're running an office, a clinic, you know, $3,000 a year, or they could be more sometimes. That's very lucrative, obviously. But there are companies that start doing that like medically where you pay like $99 a month and you're at a membership service and twice a year they send you for a blood work at like Quest and they read your blood work and then they diagnose things. Kind of weird. But we are getting to that point where we're going to be completely contactless at some point and everyone's going to be just like me, who's just a hermit who lives in their home and communicates through the computer.
Oh, man. I was listening to the Joe Rogan podcast. He had Alex Jones on.
I was literally just talking to Riley that I really want to listen to that because I heard it's pretty controversial and it was very grim, his thoughts on the upcoming vaccines.
Well, I mean, besides that, they talked about, I didn't get all the way through it. It's a hard one. He's all over the place, so it's hard to keep up with them. But they were talking about how the idea of creating this COVID or this other thing was to start to create this one world organization that has control, and they couldn't do it this way. So now they put COVID in place so they can start taking away our freedoms. And then they were talking about Neuralink and all this stuff of how they're going to start controlling us. It's very interesting stuff. The nice thing about it is that as he's saying all this absurd, ridiculous things, Joe's like stopping him, be like, all right, Jamie, fact check this. Okay, fact check this. So they're fact checking everything. And it's quite scary and impressive at the same time how much this guy gets right. You know, one of I get most of my off the wall, like conspiracy theory, new stuff from Callie Nguyen, Cookie Callie on Instagram. She's a friend from California. And she posts the best stuff. If you're like into the Epstein, if you're into all the Biden, all the conspiracy theories and stuff like that, it is fucking hilarious. It's the best. I enjoy keeping up with that stuff, but I also try to keep an open mind because I watched Social Dilemma. Have you seen that on Netflix?
Mm-hmm. I haven't. I've seen it on there, but I haven't watched it yet.
You should. It's scary to watch it. The people who've created these things become addicted to them, and they don't even know how to undo what has been done with all the social media and stuff like that. And they go over like how everything's put in place to make you crave wanting to be on your phone more and more. They took all the psychology that the casinos have put into the slot machines and stuff, and they've put that into the algorithms for, you know, likes, things popping up, notifications, and you're just constantly on your phone. It's like one of those movies that makes you really aware of how much your phone controls your life, which is really scary to think about it. Like the idea that no matter what you say, you're getting ads popped up on your phone and you're getting all this, even if you've never even researched. Like I'm sure you've had conversations with people and you said one thing and the next thing you know on your phone, there's fucking ads all for it. Yep. Like, I didn't even look this up on my phone, you know, so if they're understanding that, what else are they understanding? What do they have control over? What are they seeing? And it goes hand in hand with, you know, Alex Jones thing where he thinks that a lot of the tech companies are the ones that are controlling, you know, the world more so than governments and certain entities and stuff like that.
I think it's at a point of influencing the world versus controlling. Like, they don't have mass control as of yet. I hate to be a conspiracy theorist and say that's what they're aiming for, but they're certainly aiming for your attention. But they are. They're voice-commanded artificial intelligence in our phones with Siri or Google, you know, the whole nine. And they can listen to the words we say, and they do target our ads to us and direct the things that we want, whether we realize we want it or not. We said it, and they recognized it, so we'll put it on there. And it certainly influences our decision-making and our behavior, especially through social media. Rather than in one of the episodes we talked about that, is your opinion even yours? Is because sometimes you have your favorite influencer who says something, all of a sudden that becomes your opinion or your mindset, and you've never even looked at it or researched it from all sides. It's just that, well, I like this person, and this person said this, so that's my opinion. Yep. It was pretty common. I mean, we do become influenced by everything we see here, and there are literally engineers, like you mentioned, who use the bells, the whistles, the sounds, and the O's and the ahs that you would get in a casino to keep you. They learn what you like, and they bombard you with it, because the more you're on there, the more they can turn around to a company and sell your name as ad space, and more companies will pay for that, because they could say, hey, we've got this person on here for 4 hours a day, and this is what they're into. We'll sell you an ad to them.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. Anybody who is just wants like a more of an open mind about, you know, how social media runs, and it was all based around people who've worked for social media companies. So obviously take that with a grain of salt, right? Like, they're no longer working for these companies, so there's always a bit of bitterness involved when you're no longer making those 6-7 figures that you used to make. But I thought it was interesting. It's a cool movie. It makes me more cognizant of what I'm doing with my phone and my free time and stuff like that.
That's why everybody wants to like move off the grid now. I did watch that Cambridge Analytica documentary that was on there. I don't remember the name. The Great Hack, I think it was, or something like that, where they talk about the election in Trinidad and Tobago and then how the company was used as far as the Trump campaign and in England. It was really, really interesting and fascinating of how they swerve your opinions or bombard you with certain things to get you to think a certain way. I'm like, man, that is really scary that I could be so influenced, because we like to believe that our opinions are our own or that we've come to this or researched this. It's like, nah, sometimes we're just bombarded with something enough that we believe it.
Well, I mean, look at our industry right now, right? Like, there's such a lack of creativity within our industry that people just put out, you know, the same old stuff, kind of reinventing it, but everyone's afraid to like say something authentic. They usually just jump on bandwagon. Like, we were just talking about Squat University made a post about lower back pain when you deadlift.
Low back pumps. Yeah, low back pumps.
Low back pumps. Yes, sorry. But anyways, you know, I'm going to take advice from someone who can barely squat 225. It's like, probably not. But then it was like, but then it got backed up by Chris Duffin. So now it must be true what he said. It's like, well, just because an authority backs it up doesn't necessarily make it true all of a sudden. There's no context to it. There's nothing more like substantial that you can actually base that claim upon. It's just a blanket statement to rouse up maybe followers, maybe comments. Because if you get more comments and you're going to get more views, and that's how the algorithm works. So you're pretty much putting out content to get comments. You're not actually putting out content to help people and move the industry in the right direction. And you see that a lot with a lot of people who don't really quite fully understand what they're talking about. And they just put out a blanket statement. Same thing with like the shoulder retraction, protraction thing that went on. It was like, it's a blanket statement with no context. That just means you're unintelligent. You don't really understand the complexities of anatomy and kinesiology and biomechanics. And so just put out a blanket statement that's going to fit everyone's paradigm is ridiculous, right? The lower back pumps could be caused from what? Isometric contraction of the lower back while you're doing a hip hinge movement. I hope my lower back's isometrically contracted, or else my spine's going to have some issues maybe down the road. Or are you having lower back pumps because you have an anterior pelvic tilt, which could cause lower back pain down the road? Those are two totally different things that can yield maybe the same feeling, but one can lead to injury and one is just a consequence of doing the actual movement correctly. It's like, you know, have some creativity, put something out there that's going to challenge people's thoughts, challenge people's norms, and challenge your own, right? Like, people are so afraid to be wrong that they're just like, they'll just put out whatever everyone else is agreeing with. And it's just frustrating. I talk to Jordan Shallow about that all the time. And he's one of those guys that is, you know, super creative in his thought process. And he'll put it out there in the hopes that, like, if he's wrong, he wants somebody to challenge him and show him why he's wrong so he can continue to learn. And I think that's what the biggest hindrance is. Like, we lack creativity. We lack the desire to be wrong. We always want to be right. We never want to be wrong. And if we're always right, then we're never learning anything new. And that's a problem.
And Squat University's I'm going to use the word follower base here, but his follower base has grown exponentially. And I think that's what Duffin hopped on there for, is because when he reshares Duffin, he's being exposed to 1.4 million accounts as opposed to Duffin's several hundred thousand. You know, that's just that's just basic marketing. But it's the marketing concept that's pretty common nowadays of just being controversial or edgy because it draws people to your account. And then you're hoping that the actual content you put out keeps them around. Like, oh, this guy said something crazy. Let me see what he's about. And then you get there. It's like, oh, well, there's some good videos here. Let me stay. Let me follow. Let me do that kind of stuff. And it's not as sexy. For example, you know, your professor, Bill Campbell, puts up a lot of true or false stuff, but you're all meant to be educational. None of them are controversial. They're all meant to be educational. And he's like disproving myths with his Q&As because, like, you know, you need this amount of protein, true or false. Muscle soreness means this, true or false, you know, that kind of stuff.
And there's so much context to it as well. So
yeah.
You know exactly why it's true or false. He's not just putting stuff up there saying true or false, fight me if I'm wrong. It's like, I hate when people, it's like, you're a fucking idiot. Like, don't do that. What's wrong with you?
Yeah. Well, he's not looking for customers. And that's the difference in some of the authority base that's on there. You know, Bill Campbell is looking for students and Squat University is looking for customers. He's selling a book. He's selling a service. He's selling a subscription, whatever. He's looking for customers. And Campbell is looking for students. And I try to look at my own following the same way. People are like, why don't you have more followers? And I'm like, I really don't want followers. I want students. I want people who are going to learn from, expand on, take the concepts I believe in and help educate more people with them. Because, you know, I'm doing okay with what I'm doing business-wise and getting a great result. So I'm hoping that I have more students than followers. It's nice to have followers, but that's not my end goal. My end goal is to create a society of lifters who are more educated and helpful and a culture that everyone has the same sportsmanship and helps and contributes. That's my end goal.
Yeah. I mean, you can be part of the problem as a coach or you can be part of the solution. And at one point in time, you have to pick which one you're going to be, right? Like you have a lot of nutrition coaches that don't really understand the dynamics of nutrition, being in a deficit for a long time, what that does to the human body, the fact that women can lose their period and people think that that's okay. It's like they don't understand the health consequences that they put upon these people because one, they just want them to look a certain way so they can repost them and help their business grow, but they're not actually helping them at all, right? And then those people who get lean one time and then they're fucked up after that because they binge, their coach isn't there to help them with binging, they didn't build good habits, they didn't do all these things, their hormones are fucked up, they've put on 50 pounds, you know, they feel like shit, they have a lot of insecurities. And then it's like, well, you know, that coach just fucked those people over because all they care about is, this is the result I had, sign me as a coach. Not like, am I helping this person with long-term health? Am I helping this person build habits, create longevity, get them in a better place, both mentally and physically? And then those people come to coaches that are actually there to help them out. And those are the coaches that are like moving the industry in the right direction. But it's not, like you said, it's not going to get them a huge following. One of the people who has done it the right way is John Meadows, right? Like he's always done everything with the idea of, like, you know, best practices, trying to help people, trying to make them as healthy as possible. As you're going down, everything's somewhat backed by science and stuff like that. And it took him a while to become popular. Like he didn't become popular overnight. You know, he's been doing this for over 15, 20 years. And now all of a sudden he has, you know, hundreds of thousands of followers on Instagram and YouTube. But it's like, that's, he's built that over 20 years. And that's a legacy that he's leaving behind that's moving the industry in the right direction. Like people that, you know, say, hey, I've worked with John Meadows, those are people that I'm going to listen to a little bit more because I feel like John has sculpted them with the idea of like, health is more important than physique. Health is more important than this. Health is, and that's the context with which they tend to operate at. And I think that that's important, right? Where are you moving the industry? Are you creating problems just to get a quick cash grab, which you'll see a lot. There's like companies out there that are putting together like $10 programs. And it's like, oh, let me get this super popular person to promote this and the program shit. And, you know, they're just trying to make some money. And it's like, what are you doing to really help people? And it's like, you're not doing anything. You're not educating people. You're not creating better coaches. You're not creating better athletes. You're just fucking people over for quick bucks. And those people don't last, but it's still, they last enough to fuck people up. And it's just not a good look for the industry, I think.
Yeah, we should always be striving to increase awareness and education. That's one of my main goals. I know it's one of your main goals. And it's something we talk about a lot in Pipeline is like, you know, it's more important to be educational and what's the word I want to look for? And like you said, move the sport forward in a way that more athletes are having long-term visions, health-related visions, as opposed to just what can I do in the next 6 weeks? It's how do I stay in this for the next 6 years and still progress and still stay healthy and work on those behavior modifications versus the sex appeal and the flash of, you know, join my 6 week starter program and you're guaranteed to get 200 pounds in your total. Well, probably if it's your first day, but for a lot of people, it's just like, you're just slamming them to death with something in 6 weeks and you're showing your highlight reel as far as your lifts and you're not actually caring whether they get anywhere, get smarter or stay in this long term. You got your money and you're gone. It's like the gyms that want to sell you your 3 year membership up front because they know you're going to stop showing up for 3 months, but yeah, they sold you on 3 years.
Yeah, exactly. All right. We got some good questions, guys, and we really appreciate it. We also appreciate the reviews and the ratings we got over the last episode. Thank you for that. We're still doing the contest, so it'll end next episode. We'll pick the winner. So if you're interested in winning a free month of nutrition with me or to be a guest on the show where you can come on and bullshit with us and ask us questions, just go to iTunes, leave a review and a 5-star rating, and then just screenshot it and either tag us in it or DM it to us so we know that it's you. And we're going to pick a winner next week on the podcast. And then we'll get that going. We'll pick two winners, actually, because it's two things. So, yeah, do that. Well, I don't want to be one of those things where it's like, we're going to pick one winner and then you get to choose. No, we'll give out two things. Why not?
Absolutely. It's furthering the education and more people involved. It's great.
All right. So first question up, what sources/practices allowed you to understand anatomy/muscular function the best? I'll let you go ahead with that first, big guy.
I did that thing that was really weird that people don't do nowadays. I went to school for it. Yeah. My first anatomy teacher.
I thought you were going to say coach people in person because that's something they don't do either.
No, you know, I did that thing people. That's, yeah, I did that thing that's unheard of. Is I went to fucking college and paid attention. I went to school for it. My first anatomy teacher was one of the editors of the anatomy textbook I have. He was very proud of that. He made sure we all understood that his name was in the book. And then that was the only time he ever actually faced the class. So I fell asleep in his class every single day. It was the best hour and a half nap of my week, three times a week, because he had the whiteboard that went across the entire classroom. And other than good morning, it was the only time he faced the class until he was done. And we'd be like, okay, see you guys on Wednesday kind of thing. And he had a monotone voice and would just write on the board the entire time and never turn around. It was awful. So I'm not going to lie. My first time in anatomy, I failed. And I just was awful at staying awake in class. And I'm a perfect blend of auditory, kinesthetic, and visual learner, except he only kinesthetically and audio and visually put me to sleep. Yeah. So I had to take it a second time. And Mr. Carl was my second anatomy teacher, who was great at interacting with the class, asking us questions, helping us memorize things with anagrams and abbreviations of things and helping us do things and visualize the things. So my second go around was much better. He was not in the anatomy book, but he was a much better teacher.
That's usually how it goes, right?
Yeah.
The people that are more analytical, like writing or doing the research, usually not the best people to socially interact with and teach.
Absolutely. So this probably doesn't get discussed very often, but people talk about my understanding of anatomy and how I related to people. I was in school and I was taking the prerequisites for physical therapy. My original career track was to be a physical therapist. So I actually got certified as a neuromuscular therapist and started working as a massage therapist first, then of course as a trainer. And I just got busy and just took off and never completed my degree, which in hindsight, I do regret because I don't have the credentials, even though I would still do this anyways, regardless. But, you know, I was working with athletes and working with people who had, you know, strains, pulls, disorders, or structural problems. So I would literally out the muscle, work with the neuromuscular system, engage it. And I was working with people in person as a trainer. So every single day, I didn't just have to learn it. I was applying and using it. So I spent 19 years doing that with now 20, but 19 years doing that of learning it and then applying it. And that's the thing where people have a hard time is anatomy books are very dull and dry, but no. As a coach, you probably don't need to know some of the scientific stuff as far as the biology and things like that, unless you want to take it to that level. But you do need to understand the muscles involved, the basic structural anatomy, the innervation, so you know what you're dealing with and the issues that can arise and how they are applied. I used to have a book I went looking for, but it's missing from Dr. Charles Yacicis, which was Kinesiology in Sport.
Michael
Yacicis. Thank you. Yeah, he used to transcribe all the Russian texts and whatnot.
I have that book too. You can get it off of Elite FC. Elite FTS or Amazon? I don't know. I have that book too, the kinesiology and biomechanics book he has.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. And it's a really good one. Little dry, but it's very, very bare bones basic of a squat, a press, you know, horizontal, vertical. It has like low back extension stuff in there, deadlift stuff, and at least understand those things. To help you out, there's a couple books. Frederick Delavier, I hope I pronounced that correctly. He does Illustrated Essentials for Weight Training Anatomy. Mm-hmm. And there's like a male and a female and stuff like that. So that at least helps you if you're very visual, because he's drawing out the anatomy of the muscles involved in the main movement during primary lifts that we might do. That's also helped me exponentially. And then one thing that always helped me was keeping an open mind. The structure of the human body isn't ever going to change. We haven't changed much in 10,000 years of evolution, but you're going to see different proportions. So you might see different function from different people. Somebody with a long femur versus a short femur, somebody with a long torso versus a short torso. They still have the same muscular anatomy, but how they're able to apply it might change. Working with one-on-one clients in personal training, with understanding how to differentiate a movement or an exercise or to cue it, because, you know, just saying sit down, stand up as far as a squat isn't always going to work. You have to be very, very specific with your cues when you're dealing with someone who doesn't understand anatomy as you do, doesn't understand the terminology as you do, which is where I got used to creating a lot of very effective cues that were like silly, you know, like lockout with your cock out, pits in the pockets, you know, blowjob neck. These things are very, very funny, but they're very easy for people to remember, and they don't have to learn what cervical retraction is, thoracic extension is, hip extension is, you know, dorsi or plantar flexion. They don't have to learn these things as an athlete, but as a coach, you do need to know what you should be looking for.
Yeah, I agree. As I went to school, I also started coaching people as well. So it was definitely a different route than most people tend to go nowadays. It's like immediately online coach, never worked with anyone in person, but that's how I've learned too, is just, you know, you put people under the bar, you see how they move. If things don't look right, well, then you do your due diligence to look it up and try to figure out what's going on here. What muscles are working to create hip extension, hip flexion, knee extension, knee flexion. And then how does that combine with the diaphragm to create, you know, pelvic stability and stuff like that. And it's just going to take time. It's going to take practice, but it's going to continuously be like, well, why is this happening? Continuing to question things and then look it up. I think so many people, one of the things that I love about Dr. Scott Stevenson, when I talk to him, if I have a question, I know that I better do my research before I ask the question, because if I just ask the question, I don't ever get a real answer. He'll ask a question about my question, and then he'll make me look stuff up that I should have done in the first place, right? And I think a lot of coaches and a lot of people, they're just like, oh, well, what should I do? It's like, well, what are you trying to do? And it's like, oh, I don't know. It's like, well, then you just want me to tell you everything. Like, that's not going to make you learn anything, you know? So it's just that continued progression of asking questions of why things are happening. You may not get it right immediately, but as long as you understand the basics of, I want to say like anatomy is that important. If you don't understand kinesiology with it, like if you don't understand, you can memorize all the muscles you want, but if you don't understand origin and insertion and their function, then it doesn't really matter. And that's where the kinesiology part plays a big role. So just understanding that. And then once you get that down, then you can get into the biomechanics of it and stuff like that. But the more you work with people, the more questions they're going to present to you as athletes, right? And the way I was taught by Jordan Shallow through his prescript course is like, the way we look at athletes should be through gait cycle, right? And because that's our most prominent feature, right? Is the fact that we have gait cycle capabilities. And then you learn things about the oblique slings and anterior oblique slings and posterior oblique slings and how things connect through gait cycle and how that's the most important thing. So it's like, all right, well, you learn that, then you learn how to assess gait cycle through lunges, through, you know, patterns like that. And then it's like, then you can start seeing some of these deviations in actually biomechanics and how they're moving. And oh, they did a lunge and their hip externally rotated because they can't have internal rotation. And oh, they're doing a lunge, but they have to brace because if they don't brace, then they're not able to maintain the correct posture within that lunge. So you get to see a lot of things, but you have to be able to ask those questions, right? And you have to look for those things. You know, if your person's squatting and their knees are caving in, don't just yell knees out, because then you're gonna do shit. You know, it's like, oh, thanks, man. I was really trying to squat and make my knees touch each other. It's like, no one does that. So yelling knees out is just a stupid cue if you don't know why their knees are caving in. So then as a coach, as a good coach, like, man, this guy, every time we squat, his knees are caving in. I've tried everything. I tried putting a band around his knees. I tried doing clamshells. I've tried doing whatever it is that people do to fucking help their knees from caving in. I don't really know. And then it's like, well, let me figure out why their knees are caving. What muscles are working to make their knees cave? Oh, you know, glute med and oh, adductor and oh, this and internal rotation at the bottom of us. Then you start being able to build your like toolbox of answers to all these questions. So you have to be a coach that's asking questions. You have to understand that, right, you know, you're not gonna know everything, and that's fine. But you have to be able to ask the right questions. So that means you have to be a coach that's like looking at people. How many coaches do we see? How many trainers do we see? They're fucking training people on their phones. It's like, you're not even paying attention to your fucking client and athlete. How do you know what's going on, right? You're on your phone while they're doing the workout. Just because you showed them the exercises to do and you said to do 3 sets of 10, you should be watching every single fucking rep to see what's going on. Are their ankles caving in? You know, what's going on with their breathing and brain? People don't do that anymore. They're just so consumed with like other things going on that they're not able to pay attention. I think that's the biggest thing, right? You know, get a kinesiology book, get a biomechanics book. All that's great. But if you're not working with people and you don't have hands-on, none of that stuff is really practical. You just learned a bunch of stuff that you can't really see in person. So I think the idea of being under the bar and keeping a visual and, you know, challenging those questions, asking those questions when you see something going on, you'll be able to figure out those answers and you'll be able to retain that knowledge because you're applying it as you're doing it. And I think that's the most important thing. I mean, fuck, I've gone to school and I've read so many things and I forgot them if I don't apply them, you know? So
yep,
application is extremely important.
Yeah. There's sometimes I will come across a post that reminds me of something that I've learned, but forgotten because I haven't used it or haven't
all the time.
And you mentioned that squat and I kind of have like a checklist because we talked about applying it and you see someone's knees caving. And first it's like, well, is that even an issue that their knees are caving? Because most of the time it's not even an issue that their knees are caving. But then if it's egregious and somebody wants to fix it or improve it, you go through that checklist. It's like, okay, the first thing you check is, you know, you have them squat with bare feet to see whether their feet are collapsing, their arch is collapsing, how they're rooting, or that's not happening. And then maybe you check, like you said, the glutes and see if the glutes are working in sequence with the movement. If you strengthen them, does it improve it? If it doesn't, then maybe you're looking at a bracing issue because they lack pelvic stability. And one of the main, you know, hip extensors becomes their adductors, and the adductors are taking over because they're lacking pelvic stability. They could be lacking because they go into anterior tilt. They could be lacking because they don't know how to breathe diaphragmatically. There are so many different things, but you're going to go through that checklist from the bottom to the top. But like you said, just shouting knees out doesn't accomplish anything. Like, they know that's kind of the ideal of how they should be squatting, but clearly they're not able to physically do it just because they know it. So just shouting knees out doesn't help anyone. It just makes you feel better about shouting something. You might as well just shout up, up, up at that point. You know, knees out is ideal, but I don't like to take a lifter's mind away from the bar or away from their bracing. So the bar is on their shoulders and their center of mass is their trunk. They should be focusing on how well they're braced. If you shout something like knees out, you've pulled their mindset so far away from the bar at that point, you're actually exacerbating the problem, not helping it.
Yeah.
You want them to be stacked together under the bar. And while I'm using this as just one example, that applies for all the movements. You know, you have to have your checklist of what you're going to go through, but first decide if it's even necessary. You know, you see a lot of Asian lifters whose knees come in when they come in the bottom of a squat because they go through internal rotation to help them get deeper under the bar. Asian weightlifters work on how fast they can get under the bar and how deep they can get versus a Russian weightlifter who works on how high they can get the bar. Two different force vectors. They're accomplishing the same thing. They're both competing at the highest level. You have to decide what is the intent and what needs to be done, not necessarily what's ideal, because everyone's ideal is different.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's a really good thing to put out there. It's like, once you understand this dynamic concept of like every individual is going to be different morphologically, then you're not going to continue to be like, because I mean, we see this all the time. People are like, oh, you just can't be an upright squatter. It's like, well, yeah, maybe because your bones won't allow you to be an upright squatter. Quit trying to fucking, you know, fit into an upright squatting position because your favorite lifter does that. And I think that's important to be able to distinguish, like, okay, everyone's not going to look the same squat wise, but what makes a great squat? And then you can break it down like that. And having that checklist is extremely important. You have a checklist for everything you do as a lifter. And usually easy way to do it, just start from the feet and work your way up to the top every single time. And then that'll start showing you deficits and that'll start showing you issues. And I typically, if something presents itself in one lift, it'll probably present itself in the other lifts as well. So it's just something to think about as you're watching your lifter. So, you know, don't just watch your lifter and tell them, hey, good job. you know, be more of a analytical coach than that, right? And I think that that's the important thing, is to be able to identify those things and look for those things as a coach, for sure. And you do a great job of that when we do the seminars and stuff, being able to identify those things. And it just takes time, to be honest with you. Don't be mad if you can't figure it out the first year or two as a coach. Just understand, like, at least you're moving in the right direction and you're asking the right questions and you're trying to become a better coach. That's like step one of everything.
Yeah, by the way, Tony and I have a seminar in Dallas, Texas, coming up January 25th. So if you want me to pick you apart from feet to ceiling, come on to the seminar.
I think it's January 23rd.
Is it 23rd? I don't know. I have a whole wall behind me that has all the dates written down to make sure I show up at the right spots.
Yes, 23rd. If you're there on the 25th, which is a Monday, you'll be by yourself. But I hear it's a great gym, so it'll be good for you.
Hidden gym in Dallas?
Close to Dallas. We'll just say Dallas.
Hopefully I can find it. It's hidden.
That's true. That's true. The play on words. I'm a fan of it.
All right, we going with one of mine? Yeah. All right. So we had some great ones from Tasha. She sent some awesome questions. IronWolf03, if you don't follow her, you probably should. She's been putting up very thought-provoking, introspective things on Instagram, which is great. So shout out to Tasha for that. This kind of goes along with the question we just had, because this is one of them. How to get ahead and set yourself apart to be successful in a very saturated industry as a coach? Because we get a lot of business questions lately, and that's one that comes up, is how do you develop yourself from a branding perspective or a marketing perspective and in a saturated field of coaches? And I get that question a lot, like, what kind of content should I put up? And you talked about it. A lot of it's not reinventing the wheel. It's just saying it a little bit differently, so a way that people can understand. Yes, our market is saturated. Some coaches are better than others. Some have different systems than others. Some have different skill sets than others. What I think is provide value and education and lead with it. You mentioned John Meadows. He probably put out free content between articles and YouTube videos and training videos for 10 years before he had like 10,000 followers. And back then, it wasn't even Instagram. It was like people who would follow you on YouTube or follow you on Facebook was much harder to connect. The message boards. Yeah, he would be on the message boards. And he put out a tremendous amount of free content. And people are scared to write articles, post videos, do things. They'd rather have like a quick caption, like the Squat University thing. It's just a one quick caption, the tweet kind of thing or whatever. And yeah, that gets a conversation started, but it really doesn't lead to further education. So hypothetically speaking, let's say you put up a video and it only gets 500 views. That doesn't matter. That's 500 people who tuned in to watch and learn from you. And that's a start. You know, if you have 500 the first year, if you consistently put it up week after week after week, I guarantee you it'll be 5,000 in 5 years. And I'm not even saying you need 5,000 views. You know, it's you need enough to get the clientele you want to have or the marketplace you want to have. So if you specialize in nutrition, if you specialize in corrective exercise, if you specialize in soft tissue work or strength training or, you know, the female powerlifter or the super heavyweight powerlifter, I don't care what you specialize in. But if you have a niche that you are really, really knowledgeable in and you're putting that information out in a way that is helpful to others, they will come seek you out. They will share it. They will save it. They'll learn from it and they'll grow from it. I think people want to separate themselves, but they're not willing to actually put themselves out there in any way, shape, or form and put information out there. Or they're like, well, I've been putting information out for 3 months. Dude, I put information out for 15 years. 15 years. I was writing captions that were helping people, showing corrective exercises in my warmups, posting athlete results and meets and giving interviews and talking to people. Any chance I got to share information that would help someone, and I ask for nothing in return. I still ask for nothing in return, except that they save it so I don't have to go find it for them later, because I won't do that. I think it's, you know, you I'm offering this for free for you. You save it. It's to help you. And it took me 15 years, and that was before I even understood how social media worked. Now that I understand how it works, I get that message a little faster. But if you've been putting something out for 3 months, or, you know, a year, you haven't even scratched the surface in how many people you can reach. You just got to a point where you're already tired of putting information out there, which probably means you need to seek out more information so you have more to give, to be honest. Yeah. Because I don't think about things. I don't make a script for these things. I don't talk about things.
I would never notice. It's so on point. So
they're highly caffeinated and in the middle of a fucking workout. Like, hey, it's valuable to you. I'm not going to spend extra time preparing it, because usually it's like a lifter will send me a video or a question will come up in the gym. And I'm like, you know what? this is going to be a problem for someone. I'm going to put it out there and hopefully it helps 100 or 1,000 or 2,000 lifters, and they can save it and share it, and they can help other people with it. They can expand upon it rather than sales and marketing. You know, I don't put up a lot of buy my 6-week program, and I don't put up a lot of join my community. I just put up a lot of information that helps people, and I'm unapologetically me. You know, my personality, if you don't like it, that's okay. I'm not trying to ask you to like my personality.
That's so important.
Yeah, I'm just trying to be as authentic as I possibly can and help you be a better lifter. And I find it funny that even the people who talk shit behind my back and don't like me are still following me because they want the information too. So they don't have to like you to learn from you. Remember that.
True. One of the things that Trevor said that always makes me question why people are actually trying to be coaches is if you're at that point of like you've been putting out content for 3 months and you're frustrated because you don't have a bigger following or people aren't sharing your stuff or you feel like it's not appreciated, then that always makes me question like why you're trying to do it, right? For me, it's like I have X amount of followers. My only focus is to help them out, right? My only job is to help them out and my athletes out. I'm not trying to put stuff out there to grow my following. All I'm trying to do is help the people out that already follow me, right? Because I know a lot of coaches who have a very small following compared to the really popular people, but they make 10 times as much money because they're creating followers who actually learn something from them, who actually become their clients, who actually buy their stuff because they're focused on what they have in front of them. They're not frustrated because their following's not growing. They're so keen on trying to help people become better lifters that do follow them that they don't even think about that other stuff. Because if the goal is to be a coach and to coach people and to help them out, even if you only have 10 followers, those 10 followers should be the most important thing for you. And you should be answering their questions. And if you're only focused on answering the questions that you get from your followers, then you're putting out the content that they need. And that's the most important thing. Like, are you answering questions? Like business 101. Is there a demand for a question? Yes, there is. Are you answering that question? Are you fulfilling that demand? You know, supply and demand, right? The more you answer people's questions, the more they feel comfortable coming to you with more questions. So then you continue to build your content that way. But if you're putting out content just to grow your following and you're not putting out content to try to help the people that are actually following you already, that's where the big disconnect gets in. That means
right.
You're just trying to grow your following. You're just trying to be a social media person and you're not actually trying to be a coach to help people. And that's the biggest problem. And that's why a lot of people don't grow as coaches because their intent is to be bigger on social media. Their intent is not to put out information that's actually going to help the people that are actually following them, you know? So put up Q&As, ask people for questions, answer those questions, you know? If your clients send you questions, don't just answer those questions for that client. Put together a video that can help everyone out. There's a website I go to that's it's called Train by JP, and they have a forum section. And they also have their training logs. And anytime JP gets a question, he's like, hey, put that in the forum so everyone can learn from it. He's like, don't put it in my training log. Put it in the forum so everyone can learn. It's like, it's the same thing, right? Like if people ask you a question, if you have 10 clients, I guarantee you have 10 questions a week that there's, you know, 10 pieces of content you could put out that's not only helping your clients, but it's helping so many other people as well. Because if your clients have those questions, I guarantee you other people have those. It's like the idea of, you know, when you're listening to someone speak and they're like, anybody have questions? Like, I guarantee you the question you have, 5 other people have that question. It's just who's not scared to answer, to raise
their hand.
Right. Yeah. It's like the people that raise their hand, guess what? They get their fucking questions answered. They're learning stuff. You sat there being scared and timid. You know, I read a book, which I'm not proud of, but I read it. It's by 50 Cent. And he talks about how he's more impressed and he'll go to bat for people who ask questions in a big boardroom than the people who are too scared to. It's because those are the people who understand. They don't really care what other people think about them. They just have a question. They want it answered. And they're going to do whatever it takes to get that answer. And those are the people that are going to make it further in life because they're not scared to ask questions. And I think that as a coach, like that's what you should always be thinking about. It's like, you know, how can I answer these people questions? If this person has a question, I guarantee you 10 other people have that same question. Then you have 10 new followers because you answered a question. And that's the way to kind of differentiate yourself. Because like Trevor said, and like we've talked about, people lack creativity. People are just putting up posts to stir up controversy to get more views. And it's like, if you're constantly putting up posts to get more views, that's not the right intent to be a good coach. Like you're not changing the industry. You're not actually trying to help people. You're just trying to grow your following. And I just don't think that that's a sustainable business plan, business model.
Sure.
You know,
you want to nourish your community and not worry about it. And I can give you some great examples. I won't give you names, but I'll give you examples of people who have 3 and 4 times the following I have, but they have 3 and 4 times less the amount of clients I have because they're posting for popularity and not posting to feed their community with information or education. And it's just like, it's a look at me. And, you know, that's going to get you some free t-shirts and maybe some free supplements. And it might get you a couple invites to competitions or events. And that's great. But you can walk into the bank with your 80,000 followers and ask them how much it's worth. And the bank's going to tell you it's worth nothing. You know, the value you provide to people is what you're worth. And I don't even mean your self-worth. I mean, as far as if you're in the business of coaching, if you can't provide value, then there's no reason that people should value your business skills or your business information or whatever the business you're running. I'm assuming the book you're talking about is The 50th Law, the one he did with Robert Greene.
Yep.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's more Robert Greene than it is 50 Cent. But nonetheless, Robert Greene is great at understanding human behavior and psychology. And those are great book series. I've read The 48 Laws of Power. It's a great history lesson, too. It's a lot of fun.
Yep.
Tributes in there. And that is really important to understand when you are a coach, you're looking for buy-in and you're looking for behavior modification and you're looking to understand human behavior. So the wow factor that you have with every 800-pound lift or 900-pound squat is going to get you a lot of followers, but that doesn't mean anything. They're just watching to see what you lift. If you want to have an audience that engages, you have to communicate with them. You mentioned something. People will send me questions randomly all the time and I'll say, hey, I have a Q&A. For Coach's Corner, every Wednesday we put that in there, and every Sunday I'm home, I do a Q&A. Please put your question there so I can answer it for everybody. And there are some people who legit get pissed off. Well, can't you just answer my question? Well, first realize I get hundreds of those a week. Right. So, no, I can't just answer your question. I would love to take time to just talk to people all day. I would never pay my bills, however, or see anybody. So I put that in there because if I'm going to answer your question, I'm going to answer it for everybody. So everyone learns together. And you mentioned that JP does that on his forum, and that's really, really important because I want to educate a community. I don't want to just have one person think I'm cool. I want to have a lot of person who can be better athletes, teammates, coaches, training partners, and competitors because of this. I look at the big picture, and the big picture to me is not my follower count. It's how many people I can impact and educate.
Yeah, exactly. And if you post something up and you're not getting questions and stuff like that, then that's going to tell you that your content is not being driven in the way where people respect you as an authority too. And that's something we were talking about before the podcast, right? Like if you're a female coach and your thing is like just your ass shots and like provocative views and things like that, and yeah, you have a huge following, but then you put up a Q&A and it's like heart emojis and like eggplant emojis and like bullshit like that, and you're like, why doesn't anyone take me seriously? It's like, I can take yourself seriously.
Yeah, there's a fine line. How you want to be seen, there definitely is a fine line. And it is a bigger struggle for women than it is for men.
But there's huge.
Because for women who do that, they get the acknowledgement and they get the follower count up. But that doesn't mean that follower count is going to engage with you. They're just there to look at you. And that's important to differentiate between followers versus students. You know, and I want people who engage and interact and talk.
Yeah, for sure. And that's the same thing with guys who, you know, if you have 800-pound squat and that's all you post is your lifting, but you don't actually post content that's informative and that's actually going to help people out, then you're not going to have a lot of clients. You're not going to have a lot of athletes. You may at first, but they're not going to stay on because you're just not putting out the content that you need.
And you're not making them aware that you can help them. They don't know that. They just know that you're strong. That's it.
Exactly.
You want me to take another one or you have one for us?
No, go for it.
All right. This is a good one. Do you ever struggle with burnout? How do you deal with it? And I got to be honest with you. I have struggled with burnout so many different times in my life. It's never work burnout. I enjoy work. I enjoy getting to interact and talk with people. It does consume a lot of my time, but it severely impacts my physical. Because I tend to work 7 days a week, every day, all the time, and different things, it can affect my relationship with people because I am interacting on my phone very often and people feel like I'm not giving them the time that they deserve. And it's probably also true because I'm trying to help so many people. But, you know, when I'm getting ready for a meet or training for something, my training sometimes has to take a back seat to what I want to help other people do and achieve, which is why I try and shut off my phone notifications and I don't deal with the Instagram world until after I train now. I make that a priority. So one of the things I had to do was learn how to shut off distraction and shut off noise so I can avoid that burnout as much as possible so I can prioritize my own health and my own performance. If you're struggling with burnout, then it probably means you need to reevaluate your goals and how realistic they are, or the time frame at least you put them on there. You need to reevaluate your daily structure and your schedule and how much you can tolerate and handle. And you need to look at who you can bring in to help you. Maybe you can, direct something somewhere else. You know, if there's something else that somebody else can handle for you that you don't need to handle yourself, and you can have them do it, it's going to take a burden off of you because we have a finite capacity of energy. So if you can direct somebody else to handle things for you, whether it be your taxes, your house cleaning, your cooking, a lot of people, I know at one point Jordan Wong had one of his clients, he would buy all the food and she would cook it all prep for him, which amazing. Saved him a ton of time. And that allowed him to work more. That allowed him to train more people and do more things. And it was like, really worked out well. And I was like, that was really actually smart. He bought all the food, she prepped it for him, and he gave her a reduced rate for her training. And it's like, dude, he economized his time.
Yeah.
Delegating that responsibility was exponentially smart. And more people don't think that way. That's how I think. Can I delegate this to somebody else to make my life easier? Burnout is when you're overwhelmed by the amount of tasks you have to do. And then you start getting frustrated because you're getting further from your goal because you've taken on too much. So think of what can you delegate to somebody else? What are your priorities? And go through that checklist. And that's why I think it has more to do with behavior modification and control than the goals per se, because your goal is still going to be your goal. But how do you change your behaviors and modify your time so you can handle all of that without getting burnt out? And everyone's going to go through the post-meet blues because, you know, your excitement level goes up to here and then you're down. But that's a little bit different. That's a mood swing and sometimes a hormone change for an enhanced athlete as it is for true that's burnout.
You blast year round, guys.
The Brandon Allen way. But I think burnout has more to do with schedule, structure, and control than the actual the emotions. It's because we start taking more and more on. And the biggest key for me is learning how to eliminate the outside noise. That's why I have the phone shut off. That's why I won't go on Instagram until after 2 p.m. I want to shut out that outside noise so I have at least 4 or 5 hours where I can do deeper work and focus and not be distracted by the things that happen during the day to everybody else that I can't control anyways. I'm going to control me first and then get to them second.
Yeah, I think to piggyback on that, burnout is definitely something that happens when your expectations aren't being met, right? Like if you think to yourself, you should be doing this number on squats and this number on bench press, and you're not doing it, but you're putting in all the work to get there, that's when a lot of times you become frustrated and you become burnt out. So I think your perspective on why you're training and your ability to train is extremely important too, right? Like, you know, what does burnout mean to you, right? Like, does that mean you're going to change sports, but you're going to continue to lift? Sure, that's fine. But who says that that sport is going to give you better satisfaction than the one you just left? You know, what's causing the burnout? I think asking those questions of like, what's causing it gives you a good insight psychologically to why you're getting burnt out. Because the idea is, you know, there's what's the book called? I think it's Cal Newport, not Deep Work, but what's the other one that you have of his?
Oh, what are the Cal Newport books that are there? And Deep Work, and there's another one. I'm phoning a friend.
We had the phone.
So Good They Can't Ignore You.
Yeah.
So Good They Can't Ignore You.
The book of So Good They Can't Ignore You, the idea is, you know, not so much to follow your passion, because that doesn't necessarily lead you to success, but it's the idea of becoming so good and becoming so engulfed in your work that you just enjoy the process and you just get better and better at it. And then it eventually becomes your passion. Same thing with lifting, right? If you get more involved in the process than the outcome, then you're going to continue to enjoy that more and more than if you're just outcome driven. So I think just changing your perspective of, you know, what's the process look like? How am I going to get better? Because the idea, this is what always blows me away, is like post-meet blues, burnout, kind of all the same thing if you lump it all together. But then what happens? Like, oh, I took 3 months off and now I want to do a meet. It's like, well, you didn't get any better. So now you're going to be even more pissed off because you wanted to do a meet and you just took 3 months off. It's like, well, what are your other options, right? I mean, you know, you should always go to the gym and train, and you just have to find a way to shift that perspective of like, I get to train today, not that I have to train today, or I have the ability to get better. What are some of the things that I can do to challenge myself today in the gym that's going to create some type of fun interaction, you know, going to different gyms, hiring a different coach, putting yourself around different people. You know, you can have, you know, like Trevor said, creating those discipline habits and stuff like that. But sometimes you just need to be in a different environment that's going to create a little bit more motivation to stay consistent, right? If you go to a gym and you're the strongest person in that gym, sometimes it's hard to continue to show up day to day and put in the work. And, you know, not everyone's going to be self-aware and introspective and have that ability to continue to grind through the process and enjoy that grinding. some people need to go places where they're not the strongest person and they can be challenged by that person. So they're excited to show up to the gym every day to accept that challenge. And having a good training partner can help with burnout as well, because you don't want to let them down. They don't want to let you down. So every day you show up ready to work, you know, and I think all that's important. I think eliminating the distractions in the gym, that can cause a lot of burnout too. You know, especially when you own your own gym. There's been times where I've gone to Strength Union and it's like 30 minutes later, I still haven't even started my workout because I had to answer questions. I had to say, what's up to people? Not that it was a bad thing, because like I could have just been, hey, fuck off, I'm here to train. Not really the greatest for business or friendship development. But, you know, it's like, you know, being able to take yourself out of that environment, you know, going to, now I train at MI40 and I'm around Ben Bukolsky. And I'm around people that are getting ready for the Olympia. And it's like, I don't know them, but man, that's fucking pretty motivating to get to the gym and know that you have the best equipment. It's like, I better make the most out of this situation that I'm in for a limited amount of time. And I think that's the important thing, right? Like, make the most out of the situation you're in, because you're only going to be in the sport for a limited amount of time. It's not limitless. You're not going to be the best powerlifter for 10, 15 years, you know? So you have this small window to be really good. Do you want to be really good? If the answer is yes, then you just got to fucking have the discipline to push through burnout. You know, if you have to watch a Machiavelli motivational video every time you go to the gym just to get out of the house and make it into your fucking car, that's a problem that you need to fix, right? Because you're not building those habits. You're relying on motivation to drive you. So I think the people that rely heavily on outcome and motivation to get to the gym and to train are the ones that get burnt out really easy. The ones that just love to fucking train, they just find a way to get it done and they just find different tasks to make it challenging and to make it fun and to push them.
Yeah. And that's one of the best ways you mentioned it, of getting out of your element. You know, for a lot of people who experience this, Tasha brought the question up. She's probably the strongest and best competitor in her gym. So she's not being pushed because she is already the top dog there and other people are just trying to keep up with her. She's pushing everybody else there. So she needs to take advantage of some of her resources and find the gym where she's not the top dog and get pushed and get uncomfortable, because that reinvigorates that intrinsic motivation. Like, wait a minute, you know, I could be at the same level these people are if I just step up a little bit. So it reignites your motivation without having to watch a Matthew McConaughey motivational speech on YouTube.
Because I mean, it is true, right? Like even sports where you have to go against someone, there's still the possibility of getting burnt out, right? Like, mm-hmm. I mean, I couldn't imagine being an MMA fighter and be like, oh, I got a fight coming up in like 12 weeks, but I just don't really feel like showing up to the gym today. I'm like, well, that's not going to end well for you. First off, that's not going to be a good way to go about this. But we're in a sport that is a lot of monotony, and you just have to find ways to make it fun and make it enjoyable and continue to progress. Because if you're making progress, it's all of a sudden, it's more fun.
Yeah. You know? And the progress is harder and harder to measure the longer you're in there, but it's still being made if you're consistent. So find ways to be consistent, yes, still, especially if that means going out of your way to still get a good training environment. And you and I have done it, traveled a lot to train, do things. It's one of my favorite aspects of when I travel around, is getting to talk to people, meet people, or see people who are stronger than I am, because it still encourages me. And I kind of just like I always joke that I'm never going to enter the master's class. I still want to be in the open class no matter how old I get, because of like, I want to see what I, you know, 10 years ago I was in, or 8 years ago, like I was solidly in the top 10, and now these kids keep getting better and younger and stronger and faster. And I'm like, well, how much can I keep up with them, even though I'm, you know, 10 or 11 years senior to them in the rankings, and I'm still there with them. I'm like, that makes me feel good. That keeps me motivated.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. All right. Next question, quicker one. What do you two consider an essentials packing list for meet day? So the first question I would ask is like, well, what division are you competing in? You know, if you're a geared lifter, then obviously that's going to come with its own essential list. But if you're a geared lifter, like there's only 100 of you left, so you're probably not listening to this show. But you know, if your essentials would be like making sure you have extras of things, you know, like, oh, do I have an extra singlet just in case something happens to mine? Do I have an extra undershirt? Do I have extra underwear? Do I have extra socks? Because if your gym bag just lying around, some people may be like, oh, there's a pair of socks, let me just grab that pair. Then you have no socks there. You know, so have an extra thing so you're not stressed out is extremely important. So what I would think about is, what do I have to show the person if you're doing a USPA meet that's checking my equipment? And then that's like the essentials right there. That's what I put into my bag every time. So that's usually a t-shirt, underwear, singlet, knee sleeves, wraps, wrist wraps. Understanding that if I'm in the USPA, it has to be 2.5 meters. That way you don't show up there and they cut them, or, you know, you just don't want to have any type of unpredictable things. Wrist wraps, whatever shoes you wear for whatever lifts you're doing. Like, those are the bare essential: socks, deadlift socks, things like that. Something that we've talked about before is bring your own chalk, because you just don't know what the warm-up room is going to look like. Bring your own pair of bands. Bring your own pair. Like, however you warm up, understand that that's on you to provide yourself. It's not on the meet director to provide you the warm-up equipment that you're used to. So if you're used to certain warm-up equipment, if you're used to doing your warm-up a certain way, make sure all that's packed as well. Make sure you have a food bag of things that are easy to digest, things that you enjoy eating, things that don't upset your stomach, you know, and then also supplements, whether it be caffeine or D-ball or whatever it is you have in your medicine cabinet. I'm not here to judge you, whatever you want to do. But those are probably the only two that will work in a pinch. And let's see. I think that's it for me, man. I'm not a high maintenance person. I know I've seen people come to fucking meets and they have a suitcase. You know, I'm like, fuck, you moving in or you doing a competition? Like, what's going on here? But you may be more high maintenance than me. I'm not. What do you have?
Pretty similar. I like to make a checklist about a week out, because, you know, even though I don't drop a lot of weight for meats, you know, I'll cut the 198, you are going to go 2 days of no sodium. So you don't like to think very clearly when you're low sodium and low carb, your brain goes out the window. So I've learned through experience that you make a checklist ahead of time of everything you need to pack. And that would be anything I need on the platform, backups of some of those. So accidents do happen, backup underwear, backup socks, because if you are having, and I'll give you a tip, get black deadlift socks, don't get white deadlift socks, because the whole idea of the deadlift socks is to make sure they don't put any blood on the bar. And if you have white deadlift socks and you do a rip open anyways and you're bleeding, they're not going to let you take your lift because they see blood and they don't want on the bar. So black deadlift socks hides that pretty well. And if you're like me, you tend to scrape your shins, so you're going to bleed. So backup deadlift socks, backup singlet, just in case sometimes you get snagged on something, it tears open, or there's an issue, you don't want to be scrambling. So have a backup singlet. Have a backup t-shirt. Your wrist wraps, you plan to use it on the platform. Sometimes they can break, Velcro can rip, something you tie them aggressively. So have a backup pair of wrist wraps as well. Whatever knee sleeves you're using, whatever knee wraps you're using, you're going to gear check it. Make sure you're having a meet day. That's your fundamentals. Then I also like to, like you mentioned, supplements. I will always have a bottle of Imodium, Loperamide with me, because someone's always going to have a stomach issue and I get to be their best friend because they're like, oh, Trevor has Imodium. Somebody gets nervous or they overfed or did something stupid and they get the runs, they're really going to want that Imodium. So I always pack that with me. I like to bring things like potassium and Thermotabs, which are the sodium chloride pills, because people have cramping issues. So I usually keep those with me as well. That's on my checklist. Food, same thing you did. If it's a local meet, I can bring food with me from home. I do. If it's not that local, I will usually scout out in the area where the nearest grocery store is and make sure that they have the things I will need for meet day. And I'll bring things like Ziploc bags, whatever, so I can prepare the food ahead of time and bring it with me. So I have it on there. Make more than you think you need, because some meets are longer than others and it could be a very, very long day, or somebody doesn't have it and they just became your best friend in the community and they're going to borrow some of your food. It's a great way to make a friend. So I always bring more than I actually need, just in case, because I've had those marathon meets where it starts at 9 a.m. and doesn't end till 1 a.m. And I'm really glad I have extra food. So if worst case scenario, you're throwing out some food or you make a best friend. So have extra food on hand for that.
It's a powerlifting meet. That food is not going
to
be wasted. Guaranteed.
It won't be wasted. It really won't be wasted. Like Tony said, if you're at a major meet, sometimes you're out of control of the chalk that you use. I know that was a little bit of an issue for a lot of people at the showdown meet. The CrossFit gym they held it at had some very fine powdery chalk and everybody was dropping the deadlift bar. It is really cool when people bring their own chalk, because that eliminates that excuse and eliminates that problem. So you know and you're comfortable with the chalk. I will usually bring a couple band-aids here and there because someone does get cut open or scraped, or some athletic tape, like if your thumbs rip open, if you're a hook gripper like I am, and you just clear with the head judge. Things like that. Anything I might possibly need on meet day or on the platform, it's on my checklist ahead of time to make sure I've packed it. And I packed it and I bring it. Some people, like you said, are very extra. You know, the meet director is not going to know that you need an orange micro mini band for your warm-up. He didn't provide that for you. So if you do use that in the gym for like X-band foot walking or wall walking or external rotation, you're going to pack it. It's on you to bring it with you to use in the meet because the meet director doesn't know that you use that.
Or you can be like Dave Osborne, a good friend, and bring fucking weight releasers so you can have weight releasers and bench press like an asshole.
I mean, you know, 500-ish pound bench. So granted, it, you know, yeah, it works for him. He's on the borderline of like bench only these days. I know he's done full power, but you tease the bench only guy so much. And like sometimes I feel like Dave is just like one step away from being bench only.
For sure. I can see that.
But that's what your checklist should be. What are you going to need on meet day? And think of worst case scenario. Like, okay, if you shit your pants, you need extra underwear. If you start bleeding, you might need extra socks. If your singlet tears, you might need an extra singlet. I look at it that way because you don't want to go through worst case scenario in the meet and not have a backup plan for it. The best preventative measures are preparing ahead of time, you know? So that's what I would do on my checklist is what could possibly go wrong? How am I prepared for it ahead of time? And which is probably why you see some people with a suitcase because they have doomsday scenario mindset.
True. Very true. Also too, like to go off of what you said, if you're cutting weight and you understand like, hey, I'm pretty loopy 2 days out, maybe pack your suitcase and get everything ready to go like that Sunday. That way you're not like overly stressed. Don't be a last minute packer where you're just like, oh, I got to get this. Oh, my flight's like in 30 minutes. Oh, yeah. You know, then you start rushing. Yeah. Have all that stuff done. You know, the idea of having the stuff ready to go and being overprepared is to just minimize the amount of stress that you're going to have because you're going to be stressed out anyway because you're going to compete and you're going to have some type of anxiety, whether it's good anxiety or bad anxiety. It doesn't really matter. You just want to minimize that as much as you can. And so if you're someone who needs to get that stuff done, you know, a week before your meet, get it done. You know, just make sure that you have it, have your checklist, write it out. Don't be like, I got a checklist in my head, so I'll be fine. It's like, no. When I go to the grocery store, those with a checklist in my head, I come home and I'm like, fuck, I missed this. Oh, I missed that. Just write it down. Write it down and just check it off as you go through it. It's that simple.
There's the meet where I forgot to do things a week in advance and I got loopy and everyone, it was an RPS meet, thankfully, but I forgot my deadlift shoes and had to pull barefoot. And that was the meet. Like I waited to the last minute to pack and that was why. So I waited the last minute to pack and I was loopy and never even brought my deadlift shoes. I had everything else but. So that's the reason why I've learned to make that checklist a week out when I still have brain power.
Yeah, no, all really good points. That's it for the questions. We have a couple extra ones that we'll take into next week. We really appreciate you guys for providing us with all the great questions. Make sure you go and support Subject Zero Supplements. You know, everything you need as far as becoming a better, healthier athlete is there without any of the extra stuff, so you're not wasting your money. Renaissance Periodization, they have their app and their macro tracker. I don't know any of this stuff because I never buy it. But, Ritual Apparel, they just had a drop last Friday, I believe. So continue to check that. And then, shit, I'm getting old. Metrolife
and Iron Rebel, that completes the circle.
Iron Rebel. I think Iron Rebel has some new stuff they came out with as well.
It's being launched right now as we record this.
Oh, okay. So
it's their bodybuilding side. So it's all like sleeveless tank tops, things, you know.
Oh,
like
sleeveless sweaters. Those are such a great product. No, they got a hoodie on my sleeveless.
They didn't go that douchey to the sleeveless sweater. They haven't gotten there yet that I'm aware of.
It's like, oh, I got a fucking, you know, spaghetti string tank top with the goddamn hood on it. Like, what is going on here? I don't get that. It's like the people that show up to the gym with fucking sweatpants and a beanie, but they're shirtless. It's like, what the fuck? Like, this is so confusing. I'm looking at you right now, and I don't know if it's cold or if this is a fashion statement. What's going on? Like, why do you have a fucking beanie on and you're going shirtless? I don't get it. It doesn't make any sense. But nonetheless,
it is what it is.
Great companies, mostly ran by people that give back to the sport and powerlift and compete. I don't think Renaissance is a bunch of powerlifters, but they give so much back to strength athletics with all their free content. Yeah, if you guys aren't on Renaissance YouTube page, man, you are missing out on some fucking incredible free content that they put out there.
A lot of educational content.
If you can put up with fucking Mike Israetel blinking 15 times per second, then I think you can make it through their stuff because that distracts me a lot of times.
I like it a little bit better when James Hoffman's on there giving like the performance aspect and the recovery aspect, you know.
Yeah, for sure. Really good stuff. Appreciate you guys for listening. Keep leaving those reviews and ratings. We really appreciate it. We'll pick a winner next week. And thank you guys for sending us your questions. We really appreciate it. Have a good week, and we'll catch you guys next time.